Hey guys, this is a new build that I have on the bench. It's something I've been planning on doing for quite a while, for months actually. I saw a documentary sometime during the summer about the Korean War, and specifically the battle surrounding the Chosin River Reservoir in 1950. How to go about this. Basically, since I'm still doing the reading on it and everything, I don't have it all memorized and be ages before I do. Brief, probably inaccurate summary. The U.S. Marine Corps, I don't remember which division, they were all basically around most of the reservoir shores. While they were there, they pretty much fought their way all the way up into there, and they'd gotten in around the reservoir, which is an artificial lake that the North Koreans had made. And they had started putting in defenses and stuff like that, but the United Nations forces didn't know that the Chinese were moving into the area. And they pretty much surprised the shit out of them, and then surrounded them. So they were kind of trapped. And then over the course of a bunch of battles and encirclements and then breakouts and encirclements, they managed to break out, and there's basically one road that they could use to get back to, it's a harbor they were trying to get to. I don't remember the name of the harbor. So anyway, they had to fight their way all the way through this incredibly rugged mountainous terrain in the middle of winter, and it was a bitter, bitter winter, like very, very cold, very high winds and deep snow, and a lot of guys were killed from the winter and frostbite and gangrene, and I don't know if it was the same number that were killed by the enemy, but it was a rather large number. So it was bad. It was just really, really bad. If you watch the documentary that I saw anyway, you felt terrible for these poor bastards that were stuck there. They eventually fought their way out, and so they were basically cooking along the road. Now, this is kind of one of the important things that I found, is when they said that they bugged out, they left with a few of the trucks, these trucks there. Friggin' autofocus is on. I wish it would just stay turned off, because I hate the autofocus. So anyway, so basically these trucks here. And they said a single A3. Now, they're not specific about what kind of A3. An A3 is a Sherman tank. It could be the 105 A3 with the HVSS suspension. It could have been the A3 with the porcupine communication gear sticking all over the place. Or it could be the A3E8, which is also known as the Easy 8. Could have been any of these three. I don't know. They weren't specific, right? They just said a single A3. So these two vehicles here are just representative of what I'm going to build. I happen to have these two on the shelf from another diorama, so I just threw them on here to give you an idea of where I wanted to go with this. So the Marines were cooking down the highway, and they got to this place here called the Coterie Pumping Station, for the Coterie Electrical Station. I don't remember the name of the pass. It's like Fukushima or Fukushilima or something, Shlamari or... Furu Bing Dong Bingo Got a Dog. Anyway, something like that. I don't remember the name of the thing. It's like Fuji. Oh, shit. You're going to make me look it up, aren't you? No, I'm not going to look it up. You guys can look it up. Anyway, it's a pass that the Coterie electrical plant happens to be at the far end. They get to this pump house. They refer to it as the gatehouse. This is the building here. Now, I'm not sure if they're referring to this large concrete building, or there's a small building just down the road, a few meters, that looks more like a gatehouse to me than this. This looks like a pumping station, right, with a large concrete substructure underneath it, with these large, huge water flow pipes, outflow pipes from it. So anyway, there's a bridge section here. And there's another one on the other end that connected a road that ran up through here in front of the pumping station. And the Marines had to basically come along through here and go down the hill. Now, the Chinese and what was left of the North Korean army had gotten ahead of them and blasted this thing to hell. Now, from what I understood, there's a couple of different accounts. It sounded like the engineers had built a temporary bridge because the North Koreans had already blown this up, and they fixed it with a. They said the treadway bridge had been in place. Now, they might have been implying that the Treadway Bridge Company had done it, which is like the engineers, bridge laying engineers, or they actually used treadway bridges, which is something different. These are treadway bridges, right? That there's another story for these, right? But that's treadway bridges. And I don't see any evidence that the treadway bridges were in there before the Marines actually got there. What looks like is someone had a bunch of these logs and corrugated steel sheets up on here, and that's what they had for a bridge, and the Chinese and the North Koreans had gone in there and blew that up. So the bridge had been blown up at least twice. So anyway, so the Marines got here, which is what they're doing here, they just arrived, and they're looking at this because there's no way to get around it. There's a huge steep embankment here behind the house, and then in front of them is this almost a cliff. So there's no way through for them. And they can't backtrack. There's nowhere for them to go. So they're stuck on this long, strung-out road in single file. And the Chinese are all up in the mountains and the hills all around them, shooting at them with rifles and sniper rifles and mortars and artillery. Now, the Chinese are suffering terrible conditions as well. Actually, worse, because they didn't have much in the way of food or winter gear and ammunition. So, they were experiencing terrible conditions as well, because their leaders were something to be desired. But a lot of mistakes were made also by the American command. But one really brilliant idea they had was when they got to this point, they didn't want to leave these guys stuck here. I mean, there's a huge number of men trapped here. They ordered up a bunch of, I think they're called, I don't remember the name of the plane, Sky Train or Sky something or other. C-119, I think was the name of the number. They got a bunch of those things, and they loaded up eight of these bridge sections, these treadway bridge sections. There's two of them here. There's one here, and then there's another one bolted to it here, and it's held up by this pile of engineered logs. All right. So they got eight of these things, and they stuck them on these planes, and then they flew over an airfield that's down the hill behind these guys, and of the eight, six survived the landings. So they dragged four of them up here, and they made this treadway bridge, right? I mean, it's tied on here, and it's tied on here, and then they engineered this little pile of logs here for it to brace up on, and then they got out that way. It was pretty friggin' ballsy to do. No one had ever done anything like that before, and it was actually pretty frickin' clever. But they saved all these guys' lives, right? And these guys were in dire straits. They were seriously fucked. Right, they were totally fucked. So they managed to save them all. So that was pretty cool. So anyway, they got out and they made it to the harbor that they wanted to get to, and then the next phase of the war started. So, but anyway, so when I saw the documentary and they described this story, I was very much enthralled by it. And then I found some pictures, these pictures, of the scene. I have actually several pictures of the whole area. And I was captivated by it, and I thought, no, I could probably build this. So I thought, I could. I knew Verlinden did some treadway bridge sections, and Resicast did some treadway bridge sections. So I thought, I could probably buy some of them, and if I could get them, I know the truck, right? I have this truck already, right? I just need to get the canvas doors and the roof, right? Which I already. It's actually not here yet, but it should be here soon. I need to get some figures, which I've got some of them, but not all of them. And, excuse me, I needed an Easy 8, and I needed a turret to convert another Easy 8 into a 105 howitzer with the Easy 8 lower hull. Because I didn't know what I wanted to put here, right? And if I could get the treadway bridges, I could build this whole scene. I thought that was this way it was going to work. But then I ran into some problems. The treadway bridge sections from Verlinden are gastronomically expensive. They're just ridiculous, right? Like $120 for two, and I need four. So that's not going to happen. The ones from Resicast are M2 treadway bridges, and I need M1s, the Verlindens are M1s. So I can't use the resin cast ones because they're the wrong ones. I went looking on Shapeways. All Shapeway has is the end pieces. They don't have the full tread sections. So I had two options left. I could print off a photograph of the C-119s dropping the bridge sections out the back of the plane with the parachutes deployed and put it in the background, you know, to help tell the story. Or I could put it on a little plaque in the front, you know, because the name of the diagram is called the Chosin Few. Chosin spelled S-O or C-H-O-I-S I-N. C-H-O-S-I-N Few. It's actually not Chosin. It's actually, that's a bastardization. It's the Chinese, or the Japanese version of what the actual reservoir is called. The Koreans have a different name for it. I can't pronounce, actually. I can't pronounce the Korean word. But most people, when they refer to the battle, most English speakers, when they refer to the battle, I had to correct that, refer to it as the Chosin River Reservoir or Chosin Reservoir. Now, there's several documentaries and books and stuff that are actually called the Chosin Few or the Frozen Chosin. That's where the whole idea came from. So this will be called the Chosin or the Frozen Few. Chosin Few. So I could have like a little plaque with a little bit of information with the photograph of the treadway bridge section being thrown off the back. So that's one option. The other option is to scratch build the treadway sections, which I'm going to try doing because it leaves me the option to do the plaque thing. And the treadway bridge sections, it doesn't matter if they're there or not. It doesn't change anything other than placement of the vehicles. It means it would be reduced to one vehicle rather than two. And an increase in figures, which I was already planning on doing anyway. So I am going to try and scratch build the treadway sections, which is going to be very difficult for me because scratch building something like that is not my forte at all. I'm way outside my level of comfort. So whether or not I can do it, fuck knows. I don't know. But I can still build the diorama even if I can't do it. So, and my plan to build them is not to build four separate sections. Like here, it'll be one section made to look like there's two sections joined together. It'll be easier for me to do it that way than it is to build four separate sections and have them connected together. That just seems kind of pointless and extra work to me. So it'd just be easier to build them all into one. I have lots of reference pictures of this thing. So I have lots of material to work with, but whether or not I can mimic this detail in three-dimensional space is another thing. So, but anyway, so if I can build the treadway sections, I'm going to have the truck, the 6x6, sitting on it like this, with some fellows sitting on it, with stowage in the back, and then I'll have either the EZ8 or the M105 in the back, trailing it, and a couple of figures standing around. If I can't build it, it'll just be the truck with some guys sitting on the front, and they're waiting for the bridge sections to be arrived, and it'll be a plaque on the front with the photograph of the treadway bridges being parachuted in. Those are the two choices. Either way, that's my story. I'm going sticking with it. So as for the scene, it's mostly just built out of garbage because I can't really afford to buy real stuff anymore. I can barely afford model kits anymore because the cost of shipping is so friggin' high these days. For me, anyway, where I live in the world. For other people, they get almost a free ride, it seems, for some stuff, but not where I live. Where I live, I get to pay through the nose for shipping, and that makes everything mostly too expensive. It's funny, I was actually telling some friends of mine this after a conversation with my wife, that I'm actually looking at possibly maybe even ending my enroll in the hobby in a few years because I actually can't afford it anymore. I mean, the budget that I have for the hobby comes from my pension. Right, and my pension doesn't go up. It's exactly the same no matter what. It never increases. But I also pay some bills out of that pension, but they keep increasing. Right, so the bills aren't going anywhere. Right, I got, you know, they're always going to be there. There's no way to stop that. And you know, I have a budget. That's why I have money, because I have a budget. So eventually, the amount of money that I have every month for spending on the hobby does this. And eventually it'll become less per month than I actually need to buy even one model kit. It's almost there now, right? I mean, unless I find the kit seriously discounted, or it happens to be an old kit. If it's a new kit that just came out, it's going to cost me about $100, including shipping, or possibly $100 plus shipping to buy it. And that's the money we use here. That $100, I don't care where you're from. To me, $100 is a huge amount of money for a model kit. That's an enormous amount of money for a model kit. And it's more than I'm ever comfortable paying for a model kit. When 5 years ago, it would cost me $65 for a model kit, including shipping. That was only 5 years ago. Five years. That's it. So I'm not, and most of that is not the cost of the model kit going up so much, because it's only gone up $10 or $12 for most model kits. It's the cost of shipping it that's gone up. I mean, there's some countries I can't even buy from anymore. I can't buy in the United States for almost everything. The shipping in the United States, I don't know what's happened, but it's gone from $15 to $18 to ship a model kit to $20 to $30 to ship a model kit in the United States. That's actually well past the amount where I could even remotely think about buying anything in the United States anymore. And I'm not the only one. I know lots of guys that are going, whoa, holy cow. And they just completely stopped shopping in the United States because of it. It's unreachable now. Some places in Europe, Germany especially, Germany sometimes I get lucky, but not all the time. Not that kind of lucky. I get lucky with shipping. I've never gotten lucky in Germany. So I've never been to Germany. So anyway, sorry, I went the wrong way on that one. The shipping in Germany, sometimes it's good, but most times it's bad. I can't really afford the ship. I don't know why they charge like $50 to ship a model kit from Germany. Some guys will try to charge $50. I don't know what it is with that. And that's not just on eBay. That's like, you know, like on if some guys on Facebook and stuff like that. It's like they just don't want to sell outside Germany. Actually, that could be exactly what it is. They charge such an enormous amount for shipping international because they don't want to ship international. They could just say, I don't want to ship international. Exclude countries. You know, you can do that. But, yeah, anyway. But, you know, so, you know, there's a lot of places in Europe I can't buy from anymore. There's places in Europe I don't like buying from because the shipping is, it's not the prices, it's the method. That's a bit dodgy. But, you know, Asia tends to be where the only place I can really shop from anymore, because they're still doing that $15 to $18 shipping, or most of the time it's even free shipping, right? And the prices on the items are still quite low, reasonably. Not all the time. New kits are still out of my reach. So, you know, earlier last year I decided that new kits and I are just something in the past. I mean, I can't buy new kits anymore. I have to buy the older ones. So it's just a fact of my modeling. But that was the first chip in the block kind of thing, you know, when I couldn't buy new kits anymore. And then I had to source a new product for using my for flat coat, for a matte coat. Normally I would use Tester's dull coat, and I had to stop using that because it was becoming too expensive. So I had to shift to something a bit cheaper, but now the stuff that I'm using is cheaper for me. And it's easier for me to get, but it's still ridiculously expensive here where I am. Now, a friend of mine just bought the exact same thing, the Galleria matte varnish in the 250ml jug for £8.99, which is fairly cheap. I think that's like $15 of my money. For me to buy the exact same thing here is around $40. I could go on eBay, and it's about the same. I could go to the local craft shop that's just down the road there, and it's about $40 plus taxes, 15% taxes on that. So it doesn't matter what I do, it's going to, you know, because of where I live. You know, there's no deals for where I live, I guess. So it's things like that that made me realize, oh, I might be in trouble. And I'm a prodigious builder, right? I'm very passionate about building, and I like the pace that I'm at. It's not something I would want to reduce. Now, our hobby is about spending time enjoyably. It's about stress relief. It's about relaxation. But when you're getting all worked up about shipping prices and not being able to build the things that you want because you just can't afford them anymore, and you see friends of yours that are being able to still able to buy these things quite easily, right, because they live in a part of the world where these things literally almost fall out of the trees. But for where you are, that's not the case at all, and things are just getting more and more expensive. It's not relaxing anymore. It's actually quite stressful, right? So that's starts to eat at you after a while. You know, then the level of disappointment of, I'm going to have to stop building so much, that pops in your head. Now, when you've been doing things the way I've been doing them for so long, the idea of scaling back really isn't appealing at all. The majority of my setup in here is basically designed so I can build anything I want in any size I want, at any speed that I want. It's just because I've designed it that way. To have most of this just sit here and collect dust for months on end because I actually can't afford to come in here and sit down and work on anything, the prospect of that, because I have to restrain myself. I mean, I'm an inspiration-driven guy. You know, I'm a very artistic guy. I'm not very good with impulse control. So it's just a fact of my nature. I'm not going to apologize for it, but it's just the way I am. So I'm going to have to direct energies otherwise. And the idea of having this room the way it is stupid to me. It seems a waste. So I would probably end up just giving the hobby up altogether because it seems stupid to me to even try it. You know, if I could only build like 3 things or 5 things a year, that's not a pace I can do. If I had something else that was keeping me really busy all the time that I could only build 5 things a year, yeah, that's great. But I'm retired, and my kids are in school all day. My wife is at work all day. You know, and it only takes me a little while to get everything done that I need to do every day around the house. I have other hobbies I can do, but they're nowhere near as entertaining or as involving as this. So yeah, it's giving up an addiction. I mean, this isn't really my hobby, it's my habit. That's what I say to people. So, you know, it's not a very entertaining prospect. I know it sounds all whiny and complaining and shit, but my hobby is my buddy. You know, it's been my buddy for years. This is my therapy for my PTSD, right? And then I'm looking at the prospect of having to give it up. Well, that's not a cool thing. It's like a pet dying, right? It's kind of depressing. So I'm not looking forward to having to make some choices in the future. And I'm doing whatever I can to try and avoid making those choices if I can. Trying to find excuses to keep going. Ways to keep things cheap, like building my dioramas out of garbage like this. So, I mean, this blue stuff. This is packing material that came with a model kit. This blue foam. And I didn't use the pink stuff because I paid for that. So I used the blue stuff that I got for free, right? Because it was free. This is garbage that came with a television that my wife and I bought about 4 years ago. I saved it because I thought I might need it. This is a piece of shelf that broke, and I didn't want to throw it away. So I cut the broken edges off, and now I use it as a diorama base. This is the toilet paper roll. This is a box that one of my model kits came in about a year ago. So this is all made of garbage, right? This is foam board. My daughter used it as a part of a project that she had, right, for school. It's part of like a poster board kind of thing. I stripped the paper off, and now I use it to make sheets like this. And so, yeah, it's all built out of cast-off garbage because I can't afford to do anything else. Right? This whole thing is going to get covered in tile grout that I have left over from when I put tiles down in my bathroom 5 years ago. So I have really fine grit tile grout because I can't afford texture paste, that fancy texture paste that you buy, you know, for modeling and stuff. So I have to use tile grout, which is going to make this thing weigh 1,000 pounds, which I'm not cool with, but, you know, I really don't have a choice. So anyway, bitch, moan, whine, complain, wah, blah, blah. Third world problems, first world problems, you know. At least I'm not starving to death and I'm not freezing to death, so fuck it. Anyway, that's all I got. That was boring. You guys be good. Keep your stick on the ice. Bye for now.